Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a very warm welcome to the Reinvention Laboratory. I'm Corinna Agra, your host during this entire week in our lab, and great to have you here with us. This is already our fourth session of the day, and it is on the Market Strategy Board Technology Radar, Connecting Technologies to Standardization. And I have the great pleasure to introduce to you Petra Weiler and Peter Langtet as your hosts of this session, actually. And Peter is from IEC Regional Center for North America in Boston, and he's the secretary of IEC's Market Strategy Board. And Petra is a senior consultant at the Department Future Technology and Europe at VDE, VDI, IT in Germany. So, Petra, Peter, the floor is yours, and I'll just walk out of the stage.
Thank you, Corinna.
Thank you. Hello, thank you for coming to this Reinvention Lab session. My name is Peter Langto, as was just mentioned, and today we're going to talk about connecting technologies to standardization. And we have a few slides to go through in the next 15 to 20 minutes. And then from there, we're going to ask for your participation based on our explanation of what we did a radar survey on technologies a few years ago. And we're going to see how close we came to that, and we're going to look for your suggestions in two areas of study. So many of you have probably seen this this slide before, but just for some of those who haven't, just to put into context what the Market Strategy Board is for the IEC. And on the left-hand side, you have the Standardization Management Board, which handles the standardization factors and all the standards activities in the IEC. Then there's the Conformity Assessment Board, which handles the conformity assessment and testing and testing to the standards for compliance. And in the middle you see there is the Market Strategy Board, and that group is made up of chief technology officers and senior VPs and corporate executives from our major stakeholders. And why do we do that? We do that to provide us with a radar, a horizon for the IEC. And what I mean by that is the standards work is taking place in, you know, the 5-year horizon, 6-year, up to 10 years. That's quite long, but you get my drift here. As far as the standards work taking place today, is the standards published, it's put into action. The Market Strategy Board, what they do is they, with these chief technology officers and corporate executives, in their position in their companies, it's part of their job to look into the future to see where their company needs to be lined up for their activities, for their products, and whatever else they're doing. So we tap into their knowledge in the cases of standardization. So part of that is this board that we have a meeting once a year, and these board members come up with ideas and they discuss them, and we find out which ones through the discussions are applicable to the IEC, and then we sometimes publish a white paper on that, and that sets up a policy position, and that is shared with both other boards of the IEC. And then from there, the IEC can position itself in the coming years for those future standard needs. So the next slide is, why did we do this study? And Petra's going to speak about the methodology for the study, but what we did is through the IEC master plan, which in a short sentence is the, like any company's master plan, it's a roadmap for your activities in the coming years. It includes all departments of the IEC, and one of them happens to be the Market Strategy Board. And we were asked as the Market Strategy Board to not only do a white papers, but to do some other type of a study. And this study was to engage a technical research university, not a university, but your institute, yep, and to come up with a study, and engaging use cases, and also to bring in experts from the different stakeholders of IEC, as well as from VDE, VDI, IT. And we met for a 2-day seminar, and from there, our job was to come up with a technology radar based on the use cases and functionalities that were identified in these use cases. For the most part, Petra will correct me if I'm.
We can skip the next slide.
Okay, so it's Petra will explain the methodology of the study.
Thanks, Peter. Yeah, how do you identify the future? That's the question, and we had a certain approach to that problem. I wouldn't call it a problem or a challenge, actually. So we took a four-step approach. We first did sort of a brainstorming of what market categories could be relevant for the IEC. Actually, we had like 30 or so, a list of 30. We then clustered them, and we also did a sort of a prioritization in terms of relevance for the IEC. So you can see here a bit the markets that were in the original brainstorming, like 15 of them. You see things like Internet of Things, smart home, ambient assisted living, diagnostics, smart city. So many, many buzzwords, so to say. We clustered them. And we found that actually some of these market categories were subcategories of bigger market categories. And in the end, we came to 4 bigger ones and 6 smaller market categories, so 10 altogether, for which we then, and this is like a key part of the whole study actually, we thought, so how do we find out what the key technologies are, what the key functionalities are, what is the relevance in the future. And there's many smart people who write roadmaps and who write strategic research agendas, and research often, or in, I would say in general, come before products. So we look into these research agendas, roadmaps, trend studies, and basically for all these 10 market categories, we looked what roadmaps, what SRAs are available, and mapped them against these markets. And then for each of these market categories, not for each trend study, but for the market categories, we listed all the functionalities, the technologies, the applications that are of relevance in that market. I mentioned functionalities, and that is something worth explaining, because functionalities are independent of technologies. So we wanted to keep an open view on things. We wanted also to allow for disruptive technologies to appear in the radar later on. And that is why we said, okay, let's talk about functionalities, like sensing, like actuation, like a human-machine interface or monitoring and control, and then leave it up to the experts to say what technologies they imagine could in the future fulfill these functionalities in products that are needed by the market. So that was the step with analyzing the SRAs. We came up with fact sheets afterwards, summing up, as I said, the markets, like giving an overview of the market, summing up also the technologies that were mentioned in the studies, summing up also applications, use cases, as you say, that were mentioned, and we also put the key functionalities for that specific market. For the next step, and this is really the climax of the whole study, I would say, we used experts, as Peter said, we used experts from the IEC. Here, Panasonic was involved, State Grid, NIDEC, Underwriters Laboratories, and we also matched them with experts that VDI, VDIT is involved in different technology settings. So we also had Bosch, we had ABB, we had Festo, and you actually might see a couple of familiar faces. Thales was represented, Zorin, also for the medical sector, a wide variety of experts, as you can see. So these experts were presented with the results of the analysis of the roadmaps and strategic research agendas and trend studies, and they contributed what they thought was missing in our fact sheet, so which technologies they thought were missing, which functionalities, etc. And then what they did was a ranking of key functionalities according to the different markets. So for each market, they ranked the functionalities. We had a set of 23 at the end of the study. They ranked them, and actually in the end we choose 8 for further processing into the technology radar. So part of the workshop was also to for the experts to put all the technologies that we had identified in a technology radar for the coming 40 years, I think we said, or to, and no, 30 years until 2040. And also to complement them with other technologies that they could think of on the day. Yeah, so the results of their voting on markets, and I have highlighted the first five here, are smart cities, factories of the future, smart home, patient monitoring, and electric vehicles. Then regarding the eight key functionalities, the results were, and I go from left to right, sensing, communications, data processing, monitoring and control, human-machine interface, security and privacy, localization, and smart systems integration. There was a major further outcome, which is the technology radar. We will talk about that in more detail in a bit. I would first like to hand over to Peter for what they did with the results.
Yes, thank you, Petra. So when you see the technology radar, which we'll display in a few minutes, they were, again, forecasted out to the year 2040. And these experts in the study, in the workshop, did their best based on their company experience, based on their educational knowledge, to forecast these technologies to commercialization for the most part. And some of them were forecasted before the IEC. I put it this way, it allowed the IEC to look a little more deeply into them. And one of the technologies identified as part of the smart systems integration portion of the study was the printed electronics. And it just so happened that the IEC received a proposal from the Korean national company at that country, national committee, I'm sorry, to go and start a new committee for printed electronics. So that's one example of how the study helped the IEC. The second example was this, there was the wearable smart devices. And this was brought back into the Market Strategy Board, and the Market Strategy Board decided to go forth and write a paper, a white paper on it called Wireless Sensor Networks, which includes automation as well as other industrial applications. But that's the idea from that came from this original radar. So as part of this reinvention lab, we're going to revisit the radar. And we're going to go over two functionalities from the radar that have cross-sectional and horizontal functions and within many aspects of electrotechnology. So, so what we're going to do is we're going to connect the technology radar to standards work. So we're going to ask you in these breakout sessions, there's going to be one big breakout session, we'll divide it into two parts. But to connect this technology radar to standards work, because some of the results that were given in the radar may not be applicable today, and they may not be applicable at all. So we're going to ask you to help us with that again, because we want to see the if the predictions, how close they were. And we'll also do a quick analysis of any gaps that we find. So, and we're going to pick two functionalities, smart systems integration, and then communication, which we have some printouts of the actual radar that will allow you to look at, as well as a blow-up of those two particular functionalities. And then we're going to ask you to review these technologies and then to discuss the impact of this these technologies on the work of the IEC. And then we're going to ask you again, as part of this exercise, to prioritize or reprioritize these technologies. And then we will take this information and feed it back into IEC or the council after this session. And there will be a, you know, just a, not a report, but just a little summary of what we came up with and see how accurate it was. So I don't know if we
maybe
need
maybe until then some questions.
Yeah. So. Oops, yeah. Oh, sorry. So do you want to just give this out now? Or?
Yeah, I would, yeah.
Okay, so we're just going to stop our presentation for a minute, and we're going to hand out the technology radar, if you don't mind, thank you.
And maybe while this is being distributed, we can clarify some questions you might have or you probably have regarding the methodology, why are we doing this, you know, the different functionalities, whatever can be technical, can be procedural, anything you would like to ask or to know in more detail?
So do you want to, so in particular, do you want to ask the, if it's just the two functionalities at this point?
Okay.
So in particular, we ask that you focus on the smart systems integration and the communications portions that we've highlighted here on the display.
Everyone has a copy? Yeah? Okay. The reason why we choose these two, basically, or in particular the smart systems integration, that is my domain, so I can say why I thought it would be particularly interesting for us to look at that. And as you know, there was a session before on the systems approach, so this is really, this fits very well together. Smart systems integration combines multiple technologies. So you have all the key enabling technology that the Commission is speaking about all the time, like you have nanotechnologies, biotechnologies, you have photonics, you have advanced materials, you have manufacturing, you name it. So that was a reason for us, like bringing together all these technologies, and that the fact that this makes it very complex for also for the standardization world to bring together the experts in committees, for example. Also, there are it's cross-cutting in a way, like it has all the aspects that are currently discussed, like all this robotics and autonomy discussion, the cognitive systems, you know. It has interfaces between bio, neuro, muscular, electronics. So it is very riveting subject, and it is very relevant for standardization and for the challenges of systems work. And also, and that is true also for communications, Peter will explain that a bit, it also is not, you can't localize it in one standardization organization, so it's not only IEC, but it's also ISO, it's ITU, it's consortia, lots of consortia, it's IEEE, so that's also a point.
Yeah, so communication, as Petra mentioned, is cross-cutting for many things in the IEC, smart cities, smart factories, smart homes, and it's the basis for a lot of markets that the IEC is involved in. So personally, I'm not a communications expert, so we're going to ask for your help to find out if some of these are, whereas Petra is more involved in the systems, but we'll facilitate and ask for your feedback in these breakout sessions. So, this is the first one. It's just a blow up of, and again, it's shown here on the board, and then the second one we just mentioned is communications, and then you have that in front of you. So, before we begin the breakout session, we're going to start very shortly. Do you have any questions on the methodology or what we're doing before we get into the questions of asking you what to do? Is there any open-ended, misunderstandings or whatever, just so that way we're trying to all be on the same page and when we ask these specific questions.
Hard to believe there's no questions. Aya, here is one.
Just a simple question. Yeah, thanks, Peter. There is some of the topics are in black color and some in gray. Is it from the printer or is there?
Yeah, it's meaning? Just the printer.
There's no meaning behind this.
Yeah.
Okay. No, just sometimes. And then we will go through these four questions for each of the two selected topics, and afterwards have a wrap up. I think. Okay.
Yes.
I think the people they collect their questions. They will come afterwards.
Okay. Good.
Yeah. So, okay. So, as part of the exercise, we're going to start with, I guess, smart smart systems integration. And as we go through this exercise, we're going to try to answer each one of these four questions. And we'll also give you some adhesive paper. And we'll try to plot out again this exercise. And that's what we actually did in Berlin in 2013, where we had these large boards. It was very low-tech, but also very high-tech at the same time. So, and just because you're not an expert in a particular field that we're asking for doesn't mean you don't have an opinion, doesn't mean you don't have knowledge in a particular area. And so we're going to ask, first of all, you know, when we break out, the four questions are, do you agree with the radar? Well, I mean, some things that's hard to, you know, to predict at this moment. Your initial gaps, I mean, maybe there's something in the back of your mind that you're looking at in communication or in smart systems integration that, you know, it's obviously to you that it's not there. And then what technologies are relevant for standardization? Now, we didn't do a standardization exercise. We identified technologies, and it was up to the IEC to decide if there were standardization needs for them. So we're going to ask you, is there something in that you feel that we should be looking at a little more deeply as far as in standardization, and maybe the IEC is already covering it, or maybe it's not? And then what's the degree of urgency, so the timeline? And so, you know, is it less than 5 years, or is it greater than 5 years? So, okay, so we'll start, I guess. I guess you don't have to move because we're all doing it. We're just doing the two parts together. But I think we should start with, you know, getting to, like having some conversation as far as ideas or your feedback. Is the exercise or the radar, is it something that you would agree with, or I maybe not use the word agree, but is it something that's, you know, relevant or a good way of finding someone what we're looking for? Yeah.
Maybe while the mic is transported over there, I'd like to mention the criterion that we used for the technology radar. We told people that please put the technology in the radar at the position where you think it will be mature for commercialization. So it might be that in the radar you find technologies that we are talking about nowadays, but then please, before criticizing that it's on the wrong timeline, please think about whether it's really ripe. Yeah? Is it mature for commercialization? Can you buy it on the market or not? Okay, so.
I just want to ask what you mean with urgency. There are so many different technologies, and is this for one technology or for the whole radar, or what do you mean with urgency?
We'll try to drill down a little bit. So if it's for a specific technology, so yeah, I don't think we could do the whole wedge. Yes.
As you say, a number areas cross multiple areas, but in my own area of medical matters, I regard implantable sensors as not immediately obvious to me. Implantable devices in terms of body function monitoring and also body replacement functionality, and I would place these in smart systems integration.
Okay.
They're not immediately obvious to me on the radar, but I think in the next 5 years they will burgeon.
Yeah, thank you.
How do we give a degree of urgency? It would be lovely if we had these things tomorrow. But urgency, I would say, they will make a large difference to a large number of people on the less than 5 years scale. Are they matters for standardization? I would have thought implantable devices and their functionality and their operation, most certainly.
The implantable devices I have, which other two was it you mentioned?
Implantable devices for both monitoring and organ functionality. I'm sorry if I missed one there.
I'll get the pins, other pins.
And the degree of urgency was right. The sooner the better.
Yes.
Okay.
In terms of making a difference to people's lives.
Well, I remember that we had all this discussion about biocompatibility, and we also, of course, have the artificial organs here, and we have the bio interface and the neuro interface, the muscular interface. So I guess that goes a bit in that direction. Yeah.
Anyone else with the smart systems integration?
You're also invited to come closer to the to the boards. The question was that it wasn't so clear what was expected from the audience.
Okay.
Basically, take a look at the radar, check whether you agree with where the technologies are put in the timeline. Do you see any gaps, like any technologies that you think are missing here? And if you see a relevance for standardization, meaning, do you already know a committee that is dealing with it? Do you think there should be a committee? Do you think there should not be a committee? There shouldn't be standardization? And if you think there should, then how urgent do you think it is?
But it's now maybe a little bit the problem that it's a big pile of topics. For each of it, we are discussing about roadmaps and everything. So you might make a session out of every of these topics.
Yeah.
So
good point.
Maybe to bring it clearer what will be the expectation from us as participants in the breakout.
What I could do is I could run you a bit through the main points in this segment, at least in the smart systems segment, like some trends or some things that I see. For example, as I mentioned before, we have a lot of robotics, autonomous sensing, autonomous systems, you know. We have drones, we have cognitive systems, decision making, you know, all that is a tendency that you see in the radar. And the more cognitive it gets, or the more autonomous it gets, the further it moves towards the periphery, actually. Then you have the micro to nano tendency. So we have the MEMS, the micro electromechanical systems more here, so in the very near future. And actually, you can buy a lot of them already on the market. And the smaller you get, the further you also get towards the outside of the radar. So there's the nano robot, there's the nano electromechanical systems, there's the nano functionalization, like in nanomedicine, for example. Then you have things about materials, like form factors, flexible electronics, for example. You have large area sensors. That was in a different category. You have the functionalized materials. And then you have everything around connectivity, as I said, like the sensor network.
Maybe I can try to make a first suggestion as a question. We are talking nowadays about Internet of Things. That was yesterday a big thing in the MSB conference. We're talking about industrial internet or Industry 4.0. Is it also located in the system? Smart system integration?
Well, you have the sensor networks that I just mentioned. We have not the word Internet of Things.
A little bit more than sensor networks.
I know, but...
So the whole value chain.
It is, yeah.
Related.
Yeah. But I guess that, I mean, we have treated this as a market category, although, of course, it is relevant for different markets, and you could, of course, debate whether it's a technology or whether it's a market.
Yeah, maybe Internet of Things would be then from my point of view.
Okay.
So I'll make the first step.
Okay.
It's a gap. And where would you locate it?
I think in the smart system integration, because there's a lot of trends nowadays. I think there's a lot of trends in the moment. a lot of discussion, a lot of action, in fact, in this direction. And so I think we have to deal with it anyhow.
Okay.
Thank you.
And relevance for standardization for that point, if you are urgent?
Very urgent.
Yes.
What a surprise.
Yeah.
Minus five years.
Yeah. Okay. Let me do that. There you go, you take the green.
Stick it.
Oh. Yes.
Yeah, so thank you. I think here is really a good overview from all this head of technology, from the companies, to see what do they think when the technologies will be available. For me, as a person working in a standardization organization, I'm wondering what shall we do to offer the enablers for these technologies. And there I have one thing, is about the automated systems or autonomous systems. One thing about the autonomous systems is you don't program them how to behave with these. If sensor input is this, then output should be that. You teach these systems more how to behave. But then the question is how to make a conformity assessment for such a system. Does this system, is it safe? How to make conformity assessment. So that is for me also, and I think we should start immediately. Maybe it's already ongoing, I don't know about it, to make conformity assessment for autonomous systems.
So you would consider that a gap as well then?
I wrote it down.
At least I haven't found it. I'm not sure.
I have now put it as relevant for standardization.
I think it's a task for standardization. We have to organize it, otherwise we cannot give the answers for these guys developing or ladies developing the autonomous systems.
Well, I feel that it is on the radar. We might not have called it autonomous systems. That is why I haven't put it as a gap, right? I have put it as relevance for standardization, if you agree, which I hope.
Absolutely.
Here's one more.
Yes, I have a comment about the focus on technologies. Why here we're discussing systems. So I was wondering whether you took that into account or not, because technologies and system, more technologies and one system or many systems. And I think there is a little bit of a mismatch there. And with this in mind, what I'm missing is all what is linked to energy. Energy production, distribution, monitoring, use, less use. I can see something about grids in communication, so maybe we are going to discuss later. But for me, it's smart systems is one of the main applications, is energy. And I was wondering whether this didn't come up as a possible market or it was not chosen as a priority.
We have left the whole energy market outside of this study because there was already MSB white papers on smart grids and I think smart energy.
Yeah, microgrids and also, yes.
Yeah. And for on a technology level, we have, of course, low power devices and energy harvesting, but that is not what you mean. You mean the wider energy, the grid and stuff. Yeah. Yeah, that is the reason why it doesn't appear here.
Yes, I also want to.
Where is the?
Yeah. I accordingly to your thing. I would place an additional sector, but now you have explained that. What I'm really missing when I look at that was the sector energy distribution and so on. Now you have stated that is separate. I was wondering why energy harvesting is still on the list. Because energy harvesting is already, I think it is in the market, but on a lower power level.
Energy marking is... energy energy harvesting is one of the big challenges also in smart systems integration. So smart systems usually, or at least they should be connected, and they also should be as energy autonomous as possible. And that is why they are looking for energy harvesting solutions. So it's actually in the radar. Maybe it's not in the right place. So
one of the TCs, there is a project for energy harvesting ongoing, but I'm not sure where it is.
Yeah, I think so, that energy harvesting is still available today. And in Germany, we have a company, Enocean, which sells these products. And I think this is also in standardization already a topic. Mm. So I don't understand why this is placed after 2030.
Yeah, I can't explain actually why it's where it is. But keep in mind that energy harvesting can be done in several different ways, and maybe some are available. I know that for cars, of course, for electric vehicles, there is energy harvesting. You also have it in tires. But if you look at implantable devices, we had that example, like your pacemaker, for example. That would be great if the maintenance intervals would be shorter, because you have some sort of energy harvesting. You wouldn't need to change batteries and everything. But for that, maybe we are not as far as we are for other applications. It might be an explanation, I don't know. But I put it down, okay?
Maybe I can make a suggestion for that. It seems to me that you have applications which starts now, but you are talking about that there might be evolution over time, mm-hmm. so that you maybe have functionalities, devices, which starts now and go to 2030. Yeah, so that there's also not a fixed time when a functionality will come, but that there will be a time frame.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So, anything else? Oh, while you think of more things you could criticize on the radar, what we did in a project is a mapping between standardization activities, so TCs, and smart systems integration, the processes for production, the technologies involved, and the application sectors like health and transport and also communications, of course. And that is available online. I can post the link in the session, after the session. And you see very clearly that there's a lot of committees already for the technologies and for the things going on there. But as I said earlier, it's not one committee, right? So it's very distributed among the different standardization organizations, and it's not very transparent for the average expert, I would say. Okay, so.
Maybe one suggestion,
yep.
Not to criticize, just to bring in a suggestion as you have asked. What's about 3D printing, additive manufacturing? Is it also considered?
Additive manufacturing.
We haven't looked too much into production technologies.
No.
No. Yeah.
If it would fit, there would be a gap.
Yeah, it's a gap, you're
yeah.
right. That's an excellent example, actually, because there are so many standardization committees on additive manufacturing. ISO has one, you know, IEC has one. The aerospace yep. standardization people have one.
Okay.
You have muscular interfacing nicely represented. I think actually probably it should be a little closer to reality than it is on the radar. Mm-hmm. But I would also add to that nerve interfacing, which also raises the possibility of computer-aided vision and implanted vision sensors, although mm-hmm. sensing is mentioned elsewhere. But visual aids of an implantable kind, I think, are very important and beginning to become real effectively from the present time.
So mm-hmm. it's less than 5 years. Yeah.
So it would be pretty soon, 2020 or sooner?
Now till 2020. Crystal ball says 2020.
Crystal ball, perfect. Well, we have the neuro interface at the muscular. So it's more like we concentrated on this brain interface thing. And for a muscular interface, you say it's relevant for standardization? Or you just it was just a confirmation of where it is on the radar?
I think it's relevant for a standards input, although what that will ultimately be remains to be seen. I'm sure there are influences on safety, acceptability, degrees of functionality, and long-term effect of implantable materials on various structures as mm-hmm. well.
Excellent.
I have a question about the things which gives the smartness to the smart and autonomous system, things like data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence, cognitive computing. Did you look into this field and is it relevant?
It is of course very relevant, and of course we looked into that, like we call that the knowledge base. The question is, what is the knowledge base? Where is it? What form has it? Like, what are the items? Like, language is made up of words. What is knowledge made up of? You have all the artificial intelligence, and in this arena of smart systems integration, we put that under this cognitive aspect, and we say that in the end, the smartness should be like this decision-making support based on some knowledge, some experience, something that usually you would say only humans have, but that in the future definitely also machines will have in a form. So it's not just sensing and actuation, it is also actuation based on something, knowledge, call it knowledge cognition, whatever. Shall I write something down? Like gap? Nevertheless, I mean this, what can you repeat? The
smart.
The buzzwords that.
Yeah, the buzzwords were like machine learning, deep learning,
or more basic is data analytics, and in the end, something like you said, it, a cognitive computing or artificial intelligence, which was a phrase which was pretty much burned in the last years, and I think just this year it started to get some momentum again.
Okay.
Yep. We have.
As far as I can see, safety is only mentioned in combination with security, but safety is an aspect which is very important for every items or many items on this radar system. Why only this mentioning in security combined with safety?
Hmm. we haven't really prepared all the other segments.
There is that we couldn't answer that question as far as it was done during the study, so, and based on the roadmaps that were available to us at that time. So
perhaps I can try and answer, because safety in the classical sense, as you mentioned, Mr. Kaiser, is already established. Yeah, this is an ongoing process which is full in the hands of the standardization organizations that know how to deal with it. But the real question is, how can we combine security and safety, that, for example, cybersecurity attacks from outside do not force the robot to knock down the worker, which would not be appreciated. And this is really difficult subject for the time being, and we need solutions. The question is, when is the time frame? I didn't have it on the radar now, but anyway, it should be soon.
So it's a gap.
I mean, yeah. For smart systems, we always say that it's a requirement for them to be safe and secure, right? And for security, of course, there's also something like built-in security. Like when you manufacture them, it should already be reliable. There should be a degree of security, and therefore also they should be safe. So what do I put it as a gap?
I would put it as a gap, yeah. To it more refined.
Also, I mean, don't forget we had 23 functionalities altogether, and the radar only covers 8, the 8 that the experts during the workshop voted for the markets in terms of relevance for the IEC.
So do we exhaust the? Oh, sorry.
Maybe then. Thanks. Maybe we should write. I think the term is safety-related security. I think that is the wording that the expert want to establish. And what we need to understand is that the classical safety, like it is safety against electric shock, or also functional safety, this is basically a state of a product. It is safe or it is not safe. But with security, we have to understand it's a kind of process we have to organize. Mm-hmm. And now we have to combine these two concepts. One is a state, and the other is a process. And that's a challenge.
Yeah, very good point. Excellent.
We have one more?
Yeah.
Mm. Now we should move.
We are very happy.
It's Roland Hossein from Toronto. You know, since you are in that area on safety and reliability, I suppose for all of the systems, there'll be some kind of hardware, and therefore the chemistry of the hardware, the disposability of the hardware at the end of life, and invariably the sustainability of the materials. Because for all of it, you'd like to think certain chemicals you may not want to touch in the future because of the nature of the chemicals.
Is that also relevant for future standards needs? I know there's some probably end of life work being done.
There's some nice regulation.
Yeah.
Very good point. Yeah. Especially with some of the materials that you deal with in electronics manufacturing, you don't want that to be in the environment.
Anyone else?
I look this way.
Yeah. Okay. So.
Here is one more.
Yeah, one.
On my way. Right here on the way.
What I can't see in the communication sector is visible light communication. So with more and more LEDs, I think this will come in the near future.
That's
okay,
the
so we're going to switch to communications now.
Okay. Okay,
thank you.
What was that? Visible communication?
Yeah.
Visible light communication,
visible
VLC.
Light. Okay.
Any other relevance for standards needs or gaps in the standardization piece? I mean, communications, yeah.
No. You want to talk about other segments?
Yeah.
Well, where would you put it on the radar, actually? Like, what's the timeline?
Visible light. Greater than 5 years.
I think the first implementation will start in the near future, but I don't know how fast this will be established. And I'm not aware of any standardization activities. But this should also start in the near future, not in 5 years or 10 years.
I made another one.
Yeah.
So, another value thing. When you look at communication, it is all with energies of all kinds, and you know, what is the impact of all of that energy on people, on all people, on all biosystems, on kids, the elderly. So we have an understanding of EMF and other things, but you'll have so much of it from every system in this package and the next, and the smart system package. It's all wireless communication, and therefore it has so much energy floating around. Do we understand it? Do we understand the interferences? And do we understand the interference with biosystems?
I put that as a gap. Like the impact of energy.
There must be some standards action going on in there, but there's.
I think that's a very fine point. Certainly there is standardization interest, but it's by no means well decided and remains definitely controversial, even in its current forms, let alone the interactions between many proposed forms of energy transmission. And there must be further developments where well, let's say 100 years ago, one would not have really thought of power transmission, and yet it's a hot topic. Radar transmission, many technical radar, and so on. Things that we really can't foresee at this stage, but will have substantial safety implications and very much in the radiation area, and I welcome the comment. You're very welcome to shoot me down here because what I'm looking for as areas where great advances will be made is probably not relevant to your radar, and you're very welcome to say it's off this radar, but areas where I think there'll be big advances will be vaccination, cancer chemotherapy, cancer therapy, and antiviral chemotherapy particularly, but you're very welcome to say that that's off this particular radar.
We'll put it in the annex.
Vaccination, say that again, vaccination.
Vaccination.
Chemotherapy. Treatment.
Yeah, that is all applications. We had them, of course, in the fact sheets. So you have them all there. If you get the, I don't know whether Peter agrees that the study.
No, the study is public now.
Okay.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's not. So after the workshop, I could give it to you, but yeah.
But I put it anyway, since you say it's relevant for standardization.
Like the annex, as we like to call it.
I also have something for the annexes, I guess. And this is about the ethical aspects of technologies. Mm. All those technologies. All of them, actually, how they are used, of course, how they are developed, but then the interaction with anything else from a process management point of view, but not only. Has it ever been discussed when you were doing the radar or not? The impact on society in general.
Yeah, ethical aspects, of course, especially when you deal with anything at the interface with the human, with animals, with the environment, with food, you know, food production, Internet of Things, tags and stuff, and sensors that monitor a crop, and yeah. I don't know about standardization. I put it down that it's relevant for standardization.
In the same line, and at risk of saying too much, the impact of technologies with human psychology, human sociology, human behavior. It is certainly a controversial thing to say, but is the ubiquitous use of social media via mobile phones and so on altering sociological interaction between individuals at a personal level? Particularly teens, early 20s, and what behavior patterns and sociological patterns are being altered. So I would put that along with ethical considerations, ethical, psychological, sociological, at risk of saying too much. Thank you.
Since this corner gets bigger, we will have another bubble.
That's okay. Yes.
And just to add to that, to the last two speakers, you know, it's when you look at the entire radar, it is wealth creation for advanced economies. And therefore, what about the developing economies or the very underdeveloped economies? How do they get into it? How do they benefit from it? How do they afford it? So again, it fits on the periphery, but with all of this, it means advanced nations will advance further, and leave those behind further behind.
That is, of course, a huge market.
Yes.
If you look at it from that perspective. And for the experts in the workshop, that is a very interesting market, of course. And there are, of course, discussions of low-cost devices, you know.
The
mass manufacturing, like testing devices for viruses, for example, blood tests, things like that, for also for developing communities, countries.
But you make a good point, because the constituency of the group resembles exactly your remark.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I find it particularly interesting, because all these discussions that come up now, we have already discussed in different groups.
We can continue with the other, seeing as the communication seems to have dried up a little bit. But
maybe the radar is just perfect for communication.
Yeah.
Maybe one general question. So I think we see already that, how long is it on the market, or when did you finish the study? 2 years ago? Or three
March
years?
Of 2013.
13, so it's 3 years ago?
Yes.
And things are developing, maybe black swans are coming up and changing everything. How to update such a radar?
Another study? No, you're right. That's why we were trying to perform this exercise today. Obviously, you know, it's not an easy task, and I think the team faced the same challenges, and they're subject matter experts. So how to update it? Good question.
Maybe we are here only a small portion of the wisdom of crowds. The whole IEC community will be a much bigger crowd to be asked, and maybe you have a kind of internet platform where people can provide things and ideas and updates and suggestions. I think it's very interesting, the discussion today, to see the results, and maybe people want to participate in it also in future. Mm-hmm. And then we have a kind of digital approach also for such a radar. I think it's very interesting what have been done, mm-hmm. and maybe to maintain it also for the future.
That's a good suggestion to take forward.
Yeah. Like a wiki approach. Crowd intelligence.
Yeah.
Sounds like fun.
We can open
yes,
it up to
looking,
other.
Looking here as the wireless communication, it has been put far away here. You had broadband city networks, wireless broadband city networks, starting first 2020. Okay, it depends on what network we call. If we say that 4G is already pretty good, and 5G is on the come, but it could be a little earlier. So.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a small thing.
So just for example, then, what about the car-to-car? We hear of Google. I'm just putting this out there to the audience. The team predicted that car-to-car communication in 2030, but I think we're getting to the edge of commercialization in that.
Oh. Yeah.
That means that the cars are speaking to each other, that I am coming here and I am dangerous. Or is that the human being inside that can talk from the car to the front? Now you can talk as a human being you can talk from car to car.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's the cars that are talking with each other.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
And maybe to other vehicles.
Yeah.
Here's another one.
Yep. Just thinking about the suggestions to consider also ethical questions things like that. What about environmental issues? Are there also developments to be considered, cradle to grave, also for electronics, for electrotechnical systems, something like that? Or is it already today considered?
I don't remember if that was part of the one of the functionalities, environmental.
Yeah.
It was?
Yeah, I think.
Mm-hmm. It just it didn't make its way forward.
Yeah. No, it didn't make it to the radar.
Yeah.
We did a study, though, for the commission, I think in 2011, on organic electronics and how that impacts the environment and what could be done, etc. And that is a public study, so that's available. It didn't touch on standardization, though.
Would you say there's a need?
No.
Yeah.
More for the corner.
I should have been staying downstairs.
Yes, and we could give you some time.
Oh, you make it perfect. Yeah. Maybe another question, just discussing about environmental issues. What's about more general risk analysis for future technologies? Was it also considered in the study?
In which one? The one with the environmental impact? Or the
impact, whatever. It was talking about EMF to the human, to consider what risk might come up with technology, not only talking about functionalities.
We have put challenges for each of the market categories. Mm. Yeah. And that is where those things came up. Yeah. Okay.
So, yeah.
Yeah, we are a bit ahead of time.
Yeah.
So then maybe I can add a more general question. Peter, you mentioned about that one of the results, I think, if I remember correctly, is the foundation of the TEC, what was it, the printed electronics.
Yeah, 119. Yeah.
119,
yeah.
Exactly. Have there been other, can you give other examples how the results have been discussed? So, for example, you mentioned several times that many of the identified challenges are across the established technical committees. And well, you might think, oh, maybe we should reorganize some of them. Of course, that would be a big debate, you can imagine. But nevertheless, you can have these proposals like this. Maybe this is also, would be very interested to learn about that.
Well, the report itself was shared, to talk procedurally, the report was shared internally in the IEC again with the two other boards, and specifically the Standardization Management Board, which did review, and it was passed on through them to different committees in the timeline. So then it was publicly available on the IEC as a document, just for information. But to answer your question, those are the two prime examples. Now there may be other works going on that are subsets of what's here in the technical committees already. And from what I see, is the standards work is coming, well, particularly up to the 2020. That's why I'm saying the original radar went out to 2040, which a little, yeah. I don't want to say conceptual, but as an organization, we're not ready for that yet. It's just we're not there yet. So to answer your question, I'm not aware it's intimately with any other activities besides the ones I just showed you there.
Good.
Well, I think of course, maybe.
we are well in time.
You have one last question?
Yeah, because I think it's a great tool, and maybe we can think about to improve it and to make it even better for this, because it seems a lot of work.
Well, I think the next step would be to take these technologies and then to identify where in the IC they belong.
Yeah.
And then we can contact, and you know, I mean, it's just a matter of having open communication. Doesn't mean we just because I identified in the roadmap they have to make an action on it, but at least make them aware of it that you know this is what the market sees coming. And or in, you know, for commercialization purposes, at least.
So exactly. So that was kind of our question to you at the end of this session. We had the plan to ask you whether basically what you think of the methodology and what we did, and whether you think this can be done again or in a better way, or you know, that was our intention. So if there's any more feedback on what we did to identify the future.
It's a great process. It seems like a robust process, a transparent process. In all of this, hopefully other international bodies will not try to do the same thing. Hopefully this will be shared with the others. And you divvy up the work so that others don't try to copy it, replicate it. There's some level of partnering and harmonizing. If ISO does the same thing, it may come up with the same radar picture. And other technical, you know, SDOs will come up with the same thing. How do you avoid the proliferation? So I think it'd be worthwhile to share it with the other international bodies.
Mm-hmm. It's a good idea, and I think an accepted idea.
Yeah. Thank you. It's a good compliment also.
Yes, we have.
Yes, there's just one thing I would like to add here. You can install whatever process you have, and whatever process you want, you might not be successful all the time. That's a matter of fact, and I just would like to give you an example. Like in my previous life, I've been working for DEC, and they had what they call technology scouts.
Mm-hmm.
Also at CERN in Switzerland. They totally oversaw this little guy sitting at the, somewhere in a small cubicle. His name was Tim Berners-Lee. And they totally oversaw the whole World Wide Web coming along.
Oh.
So it might be possible that whatever you do, be aware that there might be some technology coming up which you didn't see. That's just a matter of fact, and just go along and live with it.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And that is precisely why we took this detour via the functionalities to allow for disruptive technologies to still appear, right? Independent of whether it's photonics or electronics. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Maybe also you asked for advice, or I don't know. I have an idea. It's not an advice, not yet. It's an idea. So in the recent days, I attended, of course, in my role, most of the sessions, and many people talked about agile processes. I'm not sure. Maybe it's just a buzzword. Maybe it is really a powerful trend. They talked about open platforms. So maybe we can think about how to add these elements. I mean, what we have is already a great process, as you said, and so we should not throw away, but maybe we can make it even better and think about how to open it to a certain extent, how to make it more agile, more flexible, to adapt it quickly.
That's a good suggestion, which I will take all of these comments back to the MSB as far as a report from the secretary in my function. And maybe they can commission another report taking into these considerations of the things we've identified here and maybe we've missed, you know, so with a different set of experts.
Also, I mean, we were really lucky. The framework conditions were great, and then we had some really perfect drivers of the whole process together with Annelies, who just joined us. So, hello, Anno. This was really great. And also, we had perfect experts, like a very good spread of application areas and technologies covered by the, I think we had like 12 experts, external experts, plus
your experts.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very, very quickly at the end, we've all agreed, I think, that it's a most robust and helpful way of identifying a radar. My own feeling is that it will be as good as the number of disciplines that you have involved and the width of disciplines you have involved and the width of cultures also that you will have involved. And so congratulations.
Thank you.
And an enjoyable session today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So.
Okay.
That's it. As I see discussion. Thank you very much, Pietro Weiler and Pietro Longto, and for sharing this deep insight into this interesting tool with us. And I'm sure we'll continue discussion about that. And I've heard a lot of ideas for that. And if you can take that back, I think that was also probably a very useful session for you.
Yes, part of the exercise.
Yeah. And we definitely thank the contributors, the audience. It's more than an audience, actually, because
yes.
You had to work.
Contributors.
Right?
Well, thank you so much.
Contributions.
Thank you for coming and sharing that with us. And yes, again, thank you to the audience for participating so actively. And well, our next session is already on in, 25 minutes from now. And that's going to be not only theory, but fun. You will get an insight into virtual reality and its impact in standardization practice. So stay on or come back in 25 minutes. See you then.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting communities. Reinvent standardization.